Okay, so we can start. In the previous lecture, we were discussing about the multi-threading in Java. That we supposed to be the last topic of our syllabus. So we were discussing about the threads, and we talked about various way to create threads. There are mainly two ways you can create threads in Java. One is either extending thread class or implementing the runnable interface. And in the previous lecture, we have seen how to create thread using the extending. The thread class. And so we are not going to discuss why we need threads, because you have already studied the operating system. I think you are studying the operating system, so there must be you must have studied topics like synchronization and the threads and the semaphores that we use. We will focus on the Java part, where how you can create threads in Java. So in the, we have also discussed in Java, basically threads are having a predefined priorities, starting from the main priority to max priority. The minimum priority JVM assign is 1, and maximum priority assign is 10. By default, the priority that is assigned to thread in Java is 5. Whenever a thread is created, it assigns a normal priority, which is 5. So basically how you create threads, so you extend the thread class, and you provide the overridden run method, and whenever you call the start method, it automatically runs the run methods. So whenever thread is start, so basically calling a start method does not guarantee that run method will be invoked immediately. It might be possible that thread is not in the running state, it is in the new state. When you call thread.start, it goes through the runnable state, so not in executing state. So basically, whenever processor is free, or whenever system allocates the resources for the thread, the run method runs. So that was the idea that we have seen in the previous lecture. Another way is to create thread by extending the runnable interface. Sorry, implementing the runnable interface. So you can implement runnable interface as shown in this example. So here you can see we have created a class MyThread, which implements runnable interface, and it is providing the description of run method. Now, unlike previous one, in the main class, you create the object of thread class, and in the constructor of thread object, you pass the object of the your own class, custom class that you have, that extend the implement that implements the runnable. So as it was not done in the previous case where we extend the thread class. So So as you can see on this line, thread T is equal to new thread, and we are passing the object of the custom class or user defined class that we have provided. And this is the way that you create threads in the threads when you implement the Renewal interface. And with the object of thread, with the reference of the thread T dot, you call the start method and it start the thread by running the run method. But when it run the run method, we cannot guarantee. So it depend on the resources and the processor available. The calling T dot run method. So you can explicitly call the run method also. So T dot run, but it will not be a thread. It's just a simple method. Suppose you have not written T dot start and you are just writing T dot run, and then that will work as a normal sequential program. So basically, on the above line, the thread T is equal to new thread, and when you are passing the object of the class MyThread, it is not creating the thread actually. When you call the start method, then the thread created and it invoke the run method. If you remove that line and if you directly call the run method, then it will basically calling a run method as simple as in other programs. So creating an object does not create a thread. Calling a start method creates the thread. Basically, it's the difference. Now, since we cannot guarantee the output of the execution of the thread, it might be possible thread 2 is running first and thread 1 is running second, or any order thread can be executed. So sometimes we need synchronization between the execution of the thread to prevent the data corruption. And so it allows one thread to perform an operation on an object at a time, because suppose multiple threads require an access to a particular object or particular method, synchronization helps in maintaining the consistency. So for example, if we have a class counter that maintains the count, some count is there. So suppose we have two methods, public and get count, and that returns the count value, and a set count that sets the count value. Now, so if a thread accessing a set count method and updating the count, and at the same time assuming another thread is accessing the get count at the same time, so there may be inconsistency in the value of the count, because one is setting the count and another one is accessing the count. So depending on the order of the execution, it might be possible that it may lead to a inconsistency in the value of the count. So sometimes you need to provide synchronization when you're working with the threads. It might be the case that threads are accessing the critical part of the code where data, some modification of the shared variables or shared data is happening. So you have to provide consistency between the threads. So one way is to using the synchronized keyword. So what you can do, you can provide synchronized keyword with the methods that belongs to critical section of your program. So you can provide synchronized keyword. What it does, basically, when a particular thread execute a synchronized method, so it automatically locks. Automatically place a lock, and it locks other method which have this keyword synchronized, and the lock does not lock the method without. So basically, one second. Yes. So basically, when one method running a synchronized method, so other threads are basically in the waiting state, and all other method cannot access the, for example, get count or the set count method simultaneously. Those method, even if you have some methods synchronized and other methods are not synchronized or without the synchronized keyword, so they are access, they are open to access by other threads simultaneously. So the other methods which are basically, let's say, printing value, or they're not doing any critical section of a problem, then those methods can be put with the without the synchronized keyword, and those are belongs to critical section of your problem, that can be put it with the synchronized keyword. So basically, synchronized keyword plays a lock on the object. So it locks all the other methods which have the keyword synchronized. So basically, we have seen a static keyword in some of the lecture where method or the behavior belongs to class, not the object. So in case of if you are providing synchronized keyword with the static methods, then basically the lock is placed not on the object but on the class object. So basically, class object means the class file that is created, counter.class. So not on the object, it creates the locks on the class object. And any other non-static synchronized method are still available to for the access by other threads. So it might be possible that one method is static synchronized and another method is non-static synchronized. In that case, the lock are placed on the two different objects. Basically, one is with a class object, and class object means the counter.class, and other one with the object of this class. Hence, two different threads can access the method simultaneously, basically. So it might be possible two threads, one is accessing the static synchronized and another one is accessing the synchronized set count method. Synchronized keyword locks the object, and in the previous examples we have seen, those are the implicit way to creating the synchronization between the threads. Another way is to use synchronized block, basically. And in the synchronized block, in synchronized keyword, you pass the instance that will log the object, and inside that you call the wait method and the notify all. So basically there are two methods that you use, wait and notify all, and there is another method, I think notify is there. So wait, what it does, it wait for the locks to be acquired on a particular section of the code if the objects are already locked by another method. And if it is not locked, it executes the critical section, and when its job is done, it notifies all by using notify all methods. It notify all the threads that lock is about to release by the current method. Another method, that is notify, it is used to wake up only the next method which is in the queue, normally based on the priority. That is in second on the second priority, the next priority threads is there. It notifies to that only. In notify all, it wakes up all the threads and transfer the lock to another thread which is having the highest priority. So this is the explicit way of creating synchronization between the threads, and using the synchronized keyword, you can implicitly make the thread execution in a synchronous manner. You can read out this basically this one, concurrency and synchronization, in the concurrency doc.oracle.com. This is the authentic source of reading. So this is the small introduction of multithreading in Java. So just to sum up, there are two ways. One is creating a thread class, extending the thread class, and one is by implementing the runnable interface. However, in the last class, I have asked you one question that what do you think, which approach is better to use, whether it is a extending a thread object or implementing a runnable interface. Any idea which is the better way, extending a thread class or implementing a runnable interface? Okay, so let me tell you the answer. So basically, when you extend a class, you cannot extend other class, because in Java it is multiple inheritance is not supported. So if you are extending the thread class to create threads, you might not be able to extend other classes from that class. So it is not the preferred way. Preferred way is you implement the runnable interface so that you can extend other class also. For example, your application is using applet class also. If you want to extend the applet class, so you can extend the applet class plus you can create the threads using the implementing thread runnable interface. So that's why we prefer implementing runnable class instead of extending the thread class, because you might not be able to extend other classes. So this will be the course of your object-oriented analysis and design. I think, okay, fine. No, we are not going to add new topics to the syllabus of OAD. Whatever we have covered till date, till today, it is the syllabus of your object-oriented analysis and design. We are going to have so I think 12 is the last date of the class. So we are going to have a quiz on Tuesday class, that is on 9. It will be MCQ based, again on the Google form. That will be the first quiz, major quiz, and the second quiz I'll take offline. For your internal assessment. If any question or any query regarding the syllabus or the topics or any question you can ask. Otherwise, that's it. We have finished the syllabus and we will be having quiz on 9th. Okay. Midterm syllabus. So midterm syllabus won't cover the OAD part, so design part. That is the class diagram, sequence diagram, activity diagram. Those will not be the part of midterm. And we will covering till the interface. I will update the syllabus of midterm on the Google Classroom. So those who have any doubt, they can stay. Otherwise, we are done. We are done with the OAD. Meanwhile, I will update all the lecture slides on the Google Classroom so you can see there. Quiz, yes, quiz, the syllabus for the quiz will be same as MT. So till interface, so basically exceptional handling and multi-threading won't be the part of midterm exam. Before that, interface, and abstract classes and all the topics that we have covered, those will be in the midterm and also in the quiz. So no class tomorrow, prepare for the quiz for 9th.